Okay, welcome back. So last time we talked about Kepler's laws, and we talked about how the third law is the most important of the ones that we're going to be working with because it allows us to find the mass. So this time we're going to apply Kepler's third law to the case of a binary star where I've got these two stars that are going around like this. And as we're going to see, binary stars are actually more common than even the singleton stars that are out there. And binary stars are how we figured out the mass of even the singleton stars from that. So the techniques that you learn here are going to be very important. We can even use these to find the mass of the black hole in the center of our galaxy, which we'll be doing later on. So let's get started. Okay, so as I said, we're going to be talking about binary stars. So make sure that you've got your class notes out. Looks like this, front and back. And then there's some work that we'll be doing as we go through it. So let's talk about binary stars in general first. So it turns out that most of the stars out in the sky are actually multiple star systems. As many as 85% of the bright stars that are out there are actually multiple stars. Some have four stars where you've got two binaries that are then orbiting each other. I even know of one that has five stars involved in it. So these things are actually the most common types. And so singletons like our sun actually aren't common for the very bright stars that are out there. So when we're trying to find the mass of the star, we normally can't see the planets that are going around it. So as you know from the last time, we have no way of actually measuring the mass. However, and that, again, as this says, because we need Kepler's third law says we need something going around it. However, if I know the central mass of a binary star, and then I can classify those two stars, I can figure out the individual masses. And now I can say, okay, if this is a B-type star, I can say, okay, all B-type stars have this particular mass. So just a reminder, here's Kepler's third law. And we built it up together so that we now know that M is the mass of the central object. We're going to measure that in solar masses. So this is the form with the constant we're going to be using, but we're going to solve this then for M. So remember, we had three different ways we could do this. We could find the sum of major axis, we could find the orbital period, and we could find the mass of the central object. And this is the one that we want. So that means there's two things we need to know. We need to know the sum of major axis of the orbit of the two stars. Well, that's just going to end up being the distance between them. We'll see that in a second. And then I also need the period. How long does it take for the stars to go around each other? Once I know those two, I can find the total mass of the object. And then I just need one more step and I can figure out the individual masses. So binary stars actually orbit a common center of mass. They don't actually orbit them each other so much as they're orbiting the center in between the two. And one way you can think about this, if I have a barbell and I've got equal weights on each side and I throw that thing up in the air and spin it, it's going to rotate around its center. But if I've got one end that has less weight than the other, then it's going to give this kind of lopsided thing. It's going to rotate around the center. And so that's what you're seeing here. So the central object, since they're both rotating around the center, is going to be the sum of their masses. So as I was saying, if I know the total masses, then I can find the individual masses. If I know the individual masses, and I know, for example, this is, say, a red star, and this is a B-type star, something like that, then I know that all stars that have that same spectral type, even if they're a singleton, and I can't directly measure their mass, will also have that same mass. So this is a very important technique. There are four steps to it, and the steps get to be involved. If you make one mistake anywhere in there, it's going to mess you up for the rest of the way down. So while you're working on a binary star problem, I strongly recommend just having this video up where I can walk you through it. So the four steps overall, I'm going to need the distance to the binary. We're going to use that when we're finding the sum of major axis down here. So I'm just going to calculate this and I'm going to have it set aside. You know from your tool, finding distance, you know that I need the parallax. Well, remember that the parallax is going to be the same to both stars because, duh, it's a binary. They're going to be the same distance away from Earth. So we'll find the parallax that has to be given to you. You just take one of that and you get the distance in parsecs like we've already done. However, instead of having that separation in parsecs, which is what this formula will get us, I need it in astronomical units. So this is called the small angle formula, but basically that separation is going to be measured, that s there is going to be measured in a telescope. And we're going to measure that in arc seconds. Now, just a reminder, there's 360 degrees in a circle. If I take each one of those degrees and divide it into 60 parts, That's an arc minute. Now take each one of those arc minutes and divide it into 60 parts. That's an arc second. So one arc second is 1/3600th of a degree. Tiny, tiny separation. In fact, sometimes you can't even see the separation in a small telescope. It just looks like one star. We need a big telescope to be able to see that. So what you're going to be working with in the lab in particular is you'll have a telescope view, you'll find that separation, and that's in arc seconds. However, the small angle formula, which is going to convert those arc seconds into AU, I need to have it in radians. And if you don't remember from high school, there are 2 pi radians in a circle, so 6.3 or something like that. Radians are in one circle. So to convert between arc seconds and radians, this is what I have. So I'll take my separation from the telescope, and in step two, I'll do a conversion to convert just the units from arc seconds to radians. Once I've converted it to radians, now it can go into the small angle formula that I have here. I already found the distance, so I put that in there. I just multiply by the separation in radians. Very important. Don't just take the number straight out of the telescope and put it here. You're going to get the wrong answer by a lot. So convert it to radians, and that's what goes here in the separation. So then take that number times the distance we found. That gives me the semimajor axis in parsecs, but Kepler, remember, needs it in AU. So what we're going to do is we're going to convert, again, we're going to convert that AU into, or from parsecs into AU. And we'll take you through all the steps of that here in just a second. The last thing to remember for Kepler's third law, we also need the orbital period in years. We'll normally read it off in days. That's a typical orbital period for these things. And then you'll have to convert it into years after that. All right, so let's take an example. This is Alpha Centauri A and B. That's kind of cut off by the camera there. But this is an actual photograph. This is the nearest star system to us. It's actually a trinary system. A and B go around each other, and then Proxima goes around the pair like that. And right now, Proxima is the closest to us just because of where it happens to be in its orbit. Eventually, it'll be on the other side of the pair. So this is Alpha Centauri A and B. Star B probably actually has a habitable world going around it. They're still looking into it. It definitely has a planet. So here we're giving you some data then. This is written down on your sheet down at the bottom here so that you can have it to refer back to. The parallax to Alpha Centauri is 0.75481 arc seconds, and I'm giving you lots of significant digits here. You remember, your final answer, you want to round to 3 significant digits. When we look at these in the telescope, the separation between them is 17.6639 arc seconds. Now, a lot of students get confused because these have the same units. Just because they have the same units does not mean they're the same thing. This parallax is in arc seconds because I was watching that parallax shift in a telescope. Telescopes give me arc seconds. So you can't just swap these out because they happen to have the same units. You got to keep up with which one is which. So the 0.75481 arc seconds is the parallax. The separation is 17.6639 arc seconds. That's the distance between them. So the goal then is to find the semimajor, or to find the total mass of the system. So we're going to do our steps. Here's our steps. Let's work through it one at a time. So flip on the back page. And up here at the top, we're going to do the steps. And what I suggest you do is maybe watch it the first time, but then come back and do it yourself with the video paused. All right, so the first thing we need to do is find the distance. Well, you know from your finding distance tool, you take your parallax, 0.75481, just do 1 divided by that, and that's going to give me 1.32 parsecs. That's how far away it is from here to Alpha Centauri. And that makes sense, right? Because each 1 parsec is about 1 star system over. So Alpha Centauri is our closest star system, so it should be close to 1. All right, so we've got our distance. That was straightforward. You've done that before. Now, we're going to take our separation in arc seconds here. So we're not using this until later. We're going to take this, we're going to put it down in step 3. So we're just going to hold on to that for now. For step 2, we're going to take this value and we're going to need to convert it to radians. So anytime we convert, you take what you have times a fraction bar. And of course, I've had to do it sideways because I'm trying to do all this in one line. And then I want the arc seconds to cancel. So I'll put the arc seconds on the bottom and the radians on the top. So then the 1 goes with the radians, the 206265 goes with the arc seconds. Multiply by everything in the top, divide by everything in the bottom. 17.6639 times 1 divided by 206265 gives me 8.56 times 10 to the minus 5 radians. Here's a tip for you, you might want to write this down. The radians should always be very, very small. 10 to the minus something or another. If not, you did something wrong. Go back and figure out what it is. Okay, punch this in your calculator. Make sure that you're getting the same thing I'm getting. All right, so now I have S. This is the separation in radians, which is what the small angle formula needs. I have D, because I found that before. So now I can find the distance between Alpha Centauri A and B in parsecs. Remember that that should also be a very small number, because it's the same star system. They're not going to be one star system apart. It's always going to be a number less than one. So we take our numbers here. 1.32 is the distance. 8.56 times 10 to the minus 5 is the separation. Just multiply those out, and yep, I'm getting something really small. 1.13 times 10 to the minus 4 parsecs. The very last step then, put this in calculator, make sure that you get it. And the very last step then is to convert from parsecs to astronomical units, because that's what Kepler wants. So here's our conversion. So we do it the same way. We write down what we want to convert times a fraction bar. I want the parsecs to cancel. So in this case, I'm going to put the parsecs in the bottom and the AU in the top. The 1 goes with the parsecs. The 206265 goes with the AU. Multiply by everything in the top, divide by everything in the bottom. 1.13 times 10 to the minus 4 times 206265 divide by 1. Here's my final answer for the separation, 23.3 AU. So that's the semi-major axis in between those two. And to give you a comparison, that's, you know, way out in the outer solar system, you know, out towards Neptune or so. Okay. So these stars are going around each other like this. So at this point, pause the video. Make sure you can go back and double check your answers. Make sure that you're getting the same thing I am before we move on. This is the first step. The first step actually has four parts. We got to get the semi-major axis of the orbit. All right, now to get the orbital period, because remember, Kepler needs the semi-major axis, which we've recorded here. We also need the period, so because it's a cubed divided by p squared. So when these stars pass in front of each other, they actually block some of the light. So when Alpha Centauri B, for example, moves in front, it blocks some of the light from Alpha Centauri A. And so I get this big dip here in the amount of light that I get. This is called a light curve. And so then when Alpha Centauri A comes in front, it blocks the light from Alpha Centauri B. And so I get another dip. And this is when A's in front again. This is when B's in front again. So to get the orbital period, all I need is the time from here back to here, or alternatively from here to here. You'll get the same answer. So all I need to do then is take 36,500, which is shown on your chart right here. Take 36,500, subtract the 7,300, and so the orbital period is 29,200 days. But Kepler needs it in years. So don't forget, we've got to convert to years. Well, to convert to years, just divide by 365. So do it the same way. 29,200 days times a fraction bar. I want the days to cancel. I want to be left with years. So days in the bottom, years in the top. 1 goes with the years, 365 goes with the days. 29,200 times 1 divided by 365 is right at 80 years. So the orbital period of Alpha Centauri AB is 80 years. It takes them 80 years for them to go around one time, to orbit each other one time. So to find the total mass, then, now we're going to use Kepler's third law. But now I've got everything that I need. So you see there are kind of three parts that I have to get the total mass. Figure out the semi-major axis. Those are those four steps. Figure out the period. That's usually pretty easy. Just look at the light curve, subtract them, convert it to years, and you're good. Now we need to cube the semi-major axis, square the period, and divide them, and that's going to give me the total mass. Well, the semi-major axis is 23.3 cubed. The orbital period is 80 years squared. 23.3 cubed divided by 80 squared, and I'm getting 1.28 solar masses for the total mass. Punch that in your calculator, see if you get the same thing. In fact, let's just walk through it together. So remember, it's 23.3, and then on your calculator, it might be a caret, or it might be a y to the x, or an x to the y, or something like that. On mine, it's y to the x. And then I hit 3, and I get, let's see, 23.3 to the third, I get 12,649. And then I'm going to divide by 80, and I can hit my x squared button, which is 6,400, and I get 1.98 solar masses. So the total mass, A plus B, is a little less than 2 solar masses. So A plus B together is 1.98 solar masses. So if you think about it, if you've got a barbell, The total weight on there, the total of the two, is 1.98. Now here's the trick. I've got to find the individual masses. Now, if you remember from algebra, I've got two unknowns, Alpha Centauri A's mass and Alpha Centauri B's mass. So I really need two equations. Here's my first one. So I know that A plus B, MA plus MB, is 1.98. So the second equation is something called the mass ratio. And I'll have to give that to you. But the mass ratio is basically like if Alpha Centauri A is twice as big as Alpha Centauri B, then the mass ratio would be 2. If it's 1.5 times, the mass ratio would be 1.5. That's all it is. So how much more massive is star A than star B? And then we're going to use this mass ratio, if MA is, you know, whatever it is, 1.5, 2, whatever, if MA is MB, we're going to take that part here and substitute that in for MA. We'll show you how that works. All right, so my goal is to find these individual masses. So I'm telling you that the mass ratio is 1.21 MB. That's written down on your page, down here towards the bottom. So I want to find the total mass. So here's the total mass. Would you agree this is true? The total mass is the mass of Alpha Centauri A plus the mass of Alpha Centauri B. Okay, well, we already know what that is. We already know that that's 1.98. That's what we just did all that rigmarole for just a minute ago. I also know that the mass ratio, MA, is 1.21 MB. So what I do is everywhere I see an MA in the problem, I replace that with 1.21 MB. So I stick that in there. Now I'm going to add these two. Well, this is 1.21 MB plus 1 MB. Well, 1 plus 1.21 is 2.21. Here's a hint. It's always going to be 1 higher than the mass ratio, always. So this will, if this is a 1, it'll go to a 2. If it's a 10, it'll go to an 11. You know, so don't overthink that. I'm just taking 1.21 MBs and I'm adding one more MB. And so I've got 2.21 MBs. Now, I want to get the MB by itself. What do I do? Well, it's multiplied, so I've got to divide both sides. So I get 1.98 divided by 2.21. And that tells me that the mass of Alpha Centauri B is 0.9 solar masses. So run through that, make sure that you understand how I got that. It's more important that you pause the video and go through each of those things and go, okay, yeah, I got it. There's a lot of steps here. You wanna make sure you've got each step before you try to do the whole thing. All right, so I now know the mass of Alpha Centauri B. You're almost always gonna find the B star in the binary first, the smaller star. Well, now then, finding the mass of this is even easier. I know the total mass is 1.98, so 0.9 of that, so if this is my barbell, the total is 1.98. 0.9 of that is Alpha Centauri B. Everything that's left must be A, and you can figure that out pretty straightforward. 1.98 is A plus B. So I just subtract those two, and that tells me that the mass of Alpha Centauri A is 1.08. And you probably could have figured that out before. 1.98 was the total, 0.9 was what was taken up by B. Everything that's left is A. And so there is the mass of Alpha Centauri A and Alpha Centauri B. You will have to do this in the practice. You'll have to do this in the lab. So make sure that you can do this. Binary stars are critically important to what we do in astronomy. All right, so that's where we'll stop then. You're going to want to play through this video a number of times. So make sure that you're going back to look at this. So figuring out the masses of these binary stars is critically important because, like I said, once you've classified the star, let's say that we know that Alpha Centauri A is a G-type star. In fact, it's pretty close to that, but it's a little bit less than that. But let's say we're a G-type star. Then I would know that all G-type stars would have a mass of around whatever I found for Alpha Centauri A from that. Same thing for Alpha Centauri B. So then if I run across a G-type star that's just out in space, I know what its possible mass could be, even though it doesn't have a component. All right, so go through this, go through all of the steps and practice it. Remember that the first part is the hardest part. That's figuring out the semi-major axis of the orbit. I need that so that I can get the total mass from Kepler's third law. So go through those four steps. They're really just conversions when it comes down to it. Get that semi-major axis. The period is very easy. Get that out of the light curve. Be sure to change it into years and divide those two. That gives you the total mass of the system. The mass ratio is given to you. Once you know the mass ratio, then you just solve it, put it into that total mass equation, and you'll get your final answers. So if you've got any problems with that, be sure and come into live help so that I can help you out. This is one of the sections that gives people a lot of trouble. So make sure that you're getting started early on this so you can get the help you need. All right, we'll see you next time.